picked that one girl. I said, I'm gonna marry her, which I did. And at that time, I knew that I was a different person than what I thought I was in the past. I went up to her and hugged her and kissed her. And I didn't even tell her why I was kissing her. My name is Leslie Edwards, and I'm 77 years old, born August the 9th, 1924, born in Memphis, Tennessee. And we moved here when I was 1 year old. And right now I live in Springdale, just north of Mount Healthy, and me and my wife. And we've been together for 57 years. Well, the worst part of Cincinnati at that time was the West End. That's where I was living. Me and my family, two sisters, mother and father. But during that early period, I lived reasonably well because my father was alive, and he provided for us very well. And my sisters and my mother all dressed neat and nice, and I was always neat. My house was neat and nice, and my father was a good housekeeper as well as a good provider. And he died when I was 5 years old. And it was just a few months after his death then I realized that everything would have to change. We'd have to move, and everything went downhill. It was back during the Depression years. It was back when most people was out of work in the 30s. And when I saw my mother going through a situation of having to try to make these adjustments downward, as a young child, 7, 8 years old, this was extremely frustrating to me. The housing conditions I lived in was horrible. The neighborhood was horrible, and the neighbors were horrible. Everybody was struggling. Everybody, the neighbors and my uncles and my aunts and my grandfathers and everything. My mother never got any help, even asked for any help. We didn't expect grandparents to help us. We didn't expect help. We knew we had to find a way to survive as best we could, and that meant not eating breakfast. In many cases, missing meals was part of trying to make it to the next day. And going to school was mean because you didn't have clothes, you didn't have the shoes that you needed to wear, and you didn't have no such thing as lunch money. You know, no, you didn't have no. At lunchtime, you had to find a place to hide because you were so embarrassed, because when other people was eating, you didn't have anything to eat, you know. If you had a few cents, there was a place you could go around and buy some peanuts and raisins and get some water, maybe that'd help you get you through, you know. My mother was a very good person at trying to keep the family together, because they really wanted my mother to give us away, because they told her, well, since you don't have a husband, said, we'll take these kids in the orphan home. She said, no, I'm gonna keep my kids together with me. Fact is, my mother did at one time send us back to Memphis, because my father's people in Memphis was willing to keep us. And when I went back to Memphis, and that's in the same area that Elvis Presley came out of. Fact is, he went to the same church that my people had their activities, church activities, music activities. And I was involved in a lot of activities back then when I went down there. That's where I began to sing and dance and all that other kind of stuff. And at the school down there, I was doing pretty good because the school liked to use me to put on programs, entertain and whatnot, you know. No, but while I was down there, they had a contest. In Memphis, they have these amateur contests, you know, just like the Apollo Theater in New York. They have big contests in Memphis because music is extremely important in Memphis. At this contest, I lost. I came in second, and at the time, I felt bad about it. But years later, I found out the person I was competing against was an international famous star today, Rufus Thomas. And so I really felt like, well, you know, he was a hometown boy too, you know. So I didn't feel too bad. See, my mother she wanted the family together, even though we were surviving probably better down there with my father's people. My mother wanted us to be with her, even though the living conditions was worse. She wanted her children with her. So she insisted on us coming back to Cincinnati. The school situation, and trying to look at my mother trying to do certain things, and my sisters and all around me was disaster, and somebody trying to talk to me about Shakespeare. I had no interest in these different things about whatever they was trying to teach. And the fact is, that's when I checked around and found out I could get a job in working with produce. See, they had these outside markets where you could go and help people with their produce, clean up the lettuce and celery and help them wash the different produce and help them. And I could write the signs and everything and do pretty good at that. So I was real early, I got a job with those people. And I just kind of phased out of school because I was failing anyway. Well, at that time, I knew I could work and bring money home to my mother to pay rent, to pay the light bill, see, and my mother knew that I was having a problem at school, so she and to try to keep me butting my head against the wall, which I was doing at school, and then to go out and make some money to help her, and she knew that's what I wanted to do because school was just too, it wasn't taking care of my needs, it wasn't taking care of my mother's needs, you know what I mean? And it was extremely important to me that those family needs be taken care of. And then I got a job washing dishes at downtown segregated restaurants. Everywhere I worked in a restaurant downtown, I couldn't eat in that restaurant. I couldn't drink a cup of coffee or a bottle of pop in that restaurant, but still I could work in the back and do all the work back in the back, which I did, you know. I had made up my mind early. I was never going to steal anything. I was never going to do anything that was illegal or corrupt. But I didn't care what the job was. If it paid me some money, I would do it until I could think of another way to get another job that would pay me a little more money. And the work was not my concern. The type of work was not my concern. The question was, could I make more money doing this or doing that? Whatever paid me the most money, that's what I would try to do. I didn't care what the job was. I found out I could get a hard job as working for the New York Central Railroad, outside, throwing rails, lining up railroad tracks, which was extremely hard work, and outside too, down there by the river. You work down there by that river in the wintertime. It is extremely cold, that wind blowing off that road. But I worked and did what I could to get a little better money, which I got. But I kind of hurt my back too while I was working down there because the work was real hard. But I said, well, I'm gonna try to find me an inside job, which I did. Conn's Packing House, meat packing in Cincinnati always was big. And Conn's Packing House was one of the biggest packing houses in the country. And so I found I could get a job, got a job at Conn's Packing House. And then I was making better money, but I was working in the worst part of Conn's Packing House, like all the other industries in Cincinnati, was segregated. So you had a segregated restroom, you had a segregated eating place, you had a segregated, everything was segregated. Even the plant, the better part of the wrapping and packing and the truck drivers, all that was work done by so-called white men's jobs. And they didn't hire black women to do anything at Conn's Packing House. So all the wrapping and packing was done by the women, was done by, wasn't nothing done there for, if she was black, she could not do anything at Conn's Packing House. But I worked there and in the worst part of Conn's Packing House until I was drafted. I had picked out one girl. I said, I'm going to marry her, which I did. But then after I married her, I got my papers that I was going to be drafted. And so I had to shift all my money away from my mother to my wife and had to go in service. When I went in service, I didn't like the idea of going in service because I knew my wife was going to have a child and I wanted to be around when the baby was born, see. But when I went down there to get drafted, they said, you have to come in here, that you can't concern yourself with what's happening with your wife and the child. So I had to go in. Early in the neighborhood, I became active at doing other things. Paperboy was a little task I had for a while, and during that time, I delivered papers to the house. And I found out my wife, she had lived in a horrible situation also. And I saw her situation was horrible, but she was staying with a foster person, and this foster person was giving her a place to stay, but the foster person knew not only my family, but had a lot of respect for my grandfather. And this lady, she tried to encourage me and my wife to become friendly, which we did, you know. And I saw the horrible situation, and I saw the different fellows who was interested in my wife, and I thought it'd be better if I got them out of the picture. So by me marrying her, that took care of her problem at that particular time. Well, she's, at the time when I was early, she was very clean, very neat, and she was an attractive girl, and she was honest, and I knew the jeopardy she faced, see what I mean? And I felt like between me and her, that because I like clean things, I like the clean house, and I like the neat persons, and she was attractive. I thought that me and her could be a constructive parent, you know, which we were. When they tested me and I failed, well, I failed because they was really trying to select people to do something. I wasn't aware they was trying to select quality people to put in this here Air Force situation. And because my failure showed that I didn't have all the qualifications, they said, we'll give you the test again because it's something. There's something we see. And so they give me the test a second time. And then they decided, well, we're just going to go ahead and send you with this other group that's going into this Air Force. I didn't even know. All I knew that there was some squabble about me failing the first time, and they just made a decision to give me the second test. And after the second test, they said, okay, you'll go with this here group, you know. City was developing a group that would participate in flying activities. This was a unique group in the United States. They was allowing those with African ancestry to become combat pilots, fighter pilots, and they needed people who they feel like could fill those slots, help out as support groups, develop all the things that would be needed to be an effective group, you know what I mean? And although some people really feel like they was trying to say, well, if the group fail, they won't be able to blame us for not sending them the best we could send them, see what I mean? And so as I hooked up with those folk, and they sent me down to Shepherd Field, Texas. Texas is just a big place anyway. And the airfields in Texas are so, I'd never seen anything that large. In the hangars, when you go to an aircraft hangar and you go inside, it was so big and they had all kinds of aircraft in there, all kinds of cutaways showing how the aircrafts worked. And it got me so upset because I said, I cannot handle this stuff. I don't know why they sent me down here. It worked out. I was going to be a mechanic, and they wanted to have top-notch mechanics because they didn't want these pilots to have any excuses for not being able to be effective. You see? And so when they got me involved in that, it was really disturbing to me because I was around a lot of fellows who had better education. Most of the fellows had better education than myself. And some of them came from Florida, some came from California, some came from New York, some came from Detroit. And But when they fellas saw that I was kind of shaky, those fellas talked to me. And they told me, say, we can make this. See, you can do it, we can do it. And so when we started going to the classes and started facing the instructors and different things, it was the fellas. It was the fellas around me. And some of them I had never seen before. See, but I learned to respect people that come from different parts of the United States. I learned to respect them as people. See, and realize that some of your strangers can be your best friends. It was a fellow named William Harris. And see, among the fellows, some of them was trying to plot and find out how to get out of service, how to fake illness and all that kind of stuff. And because they wanted to get out of it, see me. And so William Harris, he later told me he became a flight chief like myself. And he wound up being a Cook County Commissioner in Chicago. And he went way up in politics, but he called me later on after we got out of service. He told me, he said, when I saw what you was trying to do, and I saw what the other fellows was trying to do, he said, I made up my mind. I was going to get with you. And he said, it made me a better person. And he had a real quality family up in Chicago, too. And before he died a couple of years ago. And it really hurt me pretty bad when he passed away. From school, I had fortified myself, and I came out one of the top-notch persons from that particular school activity, that training activity. And even though I left there being one of the top-notch, if not the top-notch, I really hadn't got into the field working with airplanes. I really hadn't got active in working and doing what needed to be done. But when we left school, we went up to Michigan, Selfridge Field, Michigan, right outside of Detroit. And then they started organizing us to get with different groups. And we got with a bomber group, and we left there and went down to Godman Field, which is right outside of Fort Knox. And then they had me working at night. And me and a crew of inspectors worked in a crew of mechanics worked at night on aircraft. And at that time, I felt like because we were working at night, I would start writing down different deficiencies and different corrections and leave a report the next day. And over a period of time, they found the planes that I worked on was always ready to fly, and they always had a good report about what happened at night, so the guys that come on in the day knew what to do. And so they decided they wanted to have somebody be a flight chief. And the people in the day, the officers in the day, the administrative people, they didn't know. All they'd say is, select Leslie Edwards. And so they give me orders to come on in the day as the flight chief of Squadron 8. And so when I came in as a flight chief, during the day, that was the first time I come on a day. It was so much activity in the day, airplanes taking off, different things happening, pilots moving around. And I sit in the corner and they didn't know who I was. And then when the officer said, well, look, said, we're supposed to have a flight chief come on. His name is Edwards. And he said, all this stuff been happening today, and we haven't seen him. And I had been sitting in the corner hall that morning, and I said, my name is Edwards. And they were startled, because even when I stood up, I was small. But anyway, when I took over Flight 8, that became one of the best flights in the United States. We had one of the best safety records they had in the United States at the time. And then when they needed a special group to take a group of airplanes down to Myrtle Beach because they wanted the navigators to learn how to fly over the ocean. And the top person, B.O. Davis, he selected me and a group of fellows to go down to Myrtle Beach and have these airplanes ready so they could get this here training in, flying over the ocean. And when I went down there and started working with those airplanes, And I had those airplanes ready every day. Every airplane was ready to take off. They had no problems with airplanes, I mean. But at that time, they wanted us all to get together and take a picture, see. And they put me in the center. And at that time, I knew that I was a different person than what I thought I was in the past. See? And I knew that between education and my work ethic, see what I mean, I knew that I was a different person. We went back to our regular base in Goblin Field, and then the outfit was getting ready to go over to Japan, over the Pacific, and they sent us over to Freeman Field. When we go to Freeman Field, at Freeman Field, Indiana, they decided that the officers couldn't go into Officers Club because they had African ancestry. And this was a beautiful Officers Club, see. And some of the officers that we had now with our outfit were officers that were coming back from Europe. Some of them had been flying those fighter planes. Some of them had shot down German planes. Some of them had been all the way up into Germany flying and protecting the medium bombers over there. And when they had came back to hook up with my outfit, which was bombers, it was going to be a composite group, a group of bombers and fighters. And we was really being fine-tuned. But then when they went over to Freeman Field to really fine-tune everything, then the officers wasn't allowed into the officer club. That's when the officers said, we will submit to arrest. We will go in that, as long as that door is open, we're going into the officer's club. Here you had Freeman Field. Here we was fighting for freedom and dying for freedom over in Europe. And here we were in the United States at Freeman Field, and we were denied freedom. And even the officers, even the white officers sitting in the officer's club, they weren't allowed to play ping pong. They weren't allowed to play tennis. They weren't allowed to shoot pool with officers because they had African ancestry. They closed the officer club down after they arrested 162 officers, closed it down because they demanded those officers sign a document that you will not go into that, you'll be given a direct order and you're subject to be shot because it's during the time of war. If you violate this direct order, you will be discharged dishonorably. You can be put in jail. You will sign this paper or else you will be jailed. See, and those arrests was made. Well, it was mean. I've seen officers, tears running down their eyes, see, because they was being denied freedom right here in the United States after committing themselves to die for the United States. That made me realize that I was among a group of courageous men that would challenge it. And they wasn't belligerent. They didn't use no bad language. It was nothing hostile on their end. They were simply asking to get the same respect that any other officer was getting, see what I mean? And that was denied and they was arrested. And that was one of the meanest situations that I ever witnessed. But it was so horrible that he closed the officers' club up and they had all the officers go back to Goblin Field. And we was given orders to get all our equipment, tools, and everything else, fly the airplanes back to Goblin Field, get out of Freeman Field, because they had decided we was troublemakers or whatever. But anyway, we went back to Goblin Field, and that's where they had the court-martial. When they had the court-martial, they decided, what they decided is that this thing got so nasty that the officer's family was writing the congressman, the officer was writing the legislatures, the newspapers had picked it up and they was writing the congressman, and the NAACP head, Walter White at the time, he sent a telegram to President Roosevelt at the time. And the next day, President Roosevelt died. And so at that time, Truman came over, took over, and a decision was made that these arrests would be dropped. And but the officers at the time, our commanding officer, who was white, Colonel Selway, and Monk Hunter, who was the head of the 1st Air Force, they had collaborated that this thing would hold, they would not allow desegregation to happen to me. And so they said, well, we feel like the three of these individuals who was at the door and they brushed up against and manhandled the military police, they should be court-martialed. So they agreed to let them go ahead with the court-martial. Although there were some white officers in the Pentagon that really didn't want this to be a court-martial situation. They said, find a way to reprimand them without a court-martial. But Selway and Hunter said, we want a court-martial. And so they give them a court-martial. And at that court-martial, the NAACP's top person was Thurgood Marshall at the time. They tried to get him, but he was so busy. There were so many ugly things happening. He asked for Ted Berry to leave Cincinnati and go down, because it was 40 miles from Cincinnati, and be the defense attorney. And so when Ted Berry went down there, they had two other attorneys, but they appointed Ted Berry as the chief defense attorney. And at that trial, what happened, Ted Berry was able to get two of them off scot-free. And the one that was convicted, they fined him $150. Well, that didn't sit well with Colonel Selway and Hunter, Monk Hunter, at all, because they felt like that wasn't critical enough punishment. But that's the way it happened. But after that, then Truman and George Marshall and other top people, they began to see so many ugly incidents in the United States. You know, they decided to go with a course of desegregating, not only desegregating, but the Air Force. You had Air Force officers that realized they could get more efficiency if they utilized everybody. And there were Air Force officers who really pushed to, okay, we not only wanted to desegregate, we want to integrate and have the most efficiency we can get out of these human resources, which they did. You know, I found out what I could do as a human being, see, and I found out that if I got out, that I wouldn't ever go back to just washing dishes. I would never go back to just doing the worst things to get money. I would try to find a way to get something that was more compatible with my abilities, you know. But when I got out, the first thing that made me know is that I went to Lunkin Airport to try to get papers where I could be a mechanic, aircraft and engine mechanic. And they made me know, you will not touch any aircraft at any time. You can just forget it, see. And I've had pilots who were trained as fighter pilots tell me they experienced the same thing. And they even got a license to fly, but they were made to know that paper was worthless. Discrimination and segregation, we have a history of that in the United States, you know. I mean, after slavery, it was years and years and years of discrimination and lynching, see? Those who opposed it, in many cases, were killed without even a trial, see? And so it was a culture in the United States at that time that those with African ancestry, their grandmothers, grandfathers, had said this, in order to survive, we have to find a way to cope with this ugliness. But the fact that the Army, the United States Air Force, really, and the Tuskegee Airmen, had said, this is gonna be confronted. And we want not only a victory in Europe, we want a victory in the United States to push this here segregation, Jim Crow concept, this culture, has to go. We're going to have a victory in the United States over this meanness. But with the Tuskegee Airmen confronting it, see, and not accepting it at Freeman Field, see, that laid a basis for others to take. And then later on, what we see is what happened in baseball. They said, we're going to integrate baseball, and what happened with the school situation. Now, but you think about if they hadn't integrated the schools. If they said, no, segregation is going to be legal, if they had kept the segregated pattern, the United States would not be as wonderful nation as it is today. All those moves made the United States a much, much greater nation. I took some courses at the UC, and a lot of that stuff was transferred over in order to get me a degree at Chase, you know. But and then all the time I was working at Conn's Packing House, and but then I had a problem at Conn's Packing House because the management wanted to integrate Conn's. They had decided, talking about the 50s and the 60s, late 60s, they had decided they wanted to get away from that rigid segregation. They wanted to hire black women, they wanted to hire, and they wanted to move. And so they moved me to the wrapping room. And when they moved me to the wrapping room, it was all white except myself. And I tried to make people know I don't mind working in a wrapping room, but I need to make money for my family. And so management said, well, you come and clean the smokehouses in the afternoon and on Saturday and Sunday, and then have the smokehouse cleaned up ready for Monday, and we'll pay you extra. Well, when people in the wrapping room found out I was getting that extra money, they became upset. Now, as long as I worked in there at the lowest job, everything was okay. See? And even when somebody took a vacation in the wrapping room, they wouldn't let me take that person's job. See? Kept me at the lowest level. Bring another person from another department in to fill that person's spot. But then when they found out I was making extra money, now that really hurt me. Because here I'm trying to work with the company, work with these people, and because they found out I'm getting this extra money, they became hostile to me. So inspector, federal inspector, he saw what was happening. He said, Edwards, you don't have to take this. You take the test and become a federal inspector. And I did that. And when I went in meat inspection, they always looked upon me as being a quality person because of the high scores I made whenever I took any tests, you know. And but then when I became a meat inspector with the federal government, they sent me up to Dayton to work. And I worked up there for about 3 years off and on up in Dayton. And then when they decided to cut back the forces with the federal inspectors, they wanted to send me to Chicago. I said, no, I'll just change over and start working with the state. So I got a job with the state as a supervisor of inspectors. And that's when the state was trying to start their own inspection program for meat and poultry and everything. So getting that job with the state as a supervisor, then I was able to really start trying to bring in real programs that I felt would be effective. Because when you're at that supervisor, you can start sitting programs and developing policies and deciding how you're going to do certain things. And so in the Cincinnati area, in the Hamilton, in Southern Ohio, we was all over Southern Ohio. It wasn't just Cincinnati. We began to work with the producer, and I tried to work with producers as somewhat of a consultant. I tried to make the producer know if he produced a consistent quality product, he could get repeat business. And the product would be wholesome, it'd be safe, and he'd get a reputation. Of course, it takes a year or so to convince people, and you have an inspection team, you have to have inspectors to know how to work with people to get that thing done, see. But then when you find out people, there are certain people that wants to be sleazy, they wants to gouge the public, they want to put out contaminated product and conceal it to me. As an inspector, this is when my consultant have to be set aside and have to function as an inspector and put a stop, see, put a stop to that activity, which we had to stop a number of people in Southern Ohio. Well, we have one of the top-notch programs in the United States. That's why in the Southern area, when you see a whole lot of problems with people getting sick because of food, with E. coli and Salmonella and Shigella and like that, you don't have a lot of that problem here in Cincinnati. I mean, you don't have that a lot of problem in Southern Ohio, because we have made the producers around here know how to produce a wholesome product consistently. And since I've been out, I retired a couple of years ago, but I still have contact with a lot of the inspectors and a lot of management people. And they still respect what I did for them in order to help them know and have procedures and have strategies to keep a good product under control. See? And that's what we've done. See? No, I didn't have a lot of time because when you're working really on certain inspection jobs, and certain, they carry you out of town, you have to go different places to get training courses. The amount of training you have to take in order to be a good inspector. See, you're inspecting poultry, you're inspecting turkeys, you're inspecting chickens, you're inspecting the processing of meat, you all kind of chemicals in hams, bolognese, lunch meats. You're inspecting the killing of sheep. You're inspecting the killing of cattle, swine. And you got to learn all of that. You got to go to courses. You got to take many, many, many courses, you know, and some of the courses carry you out of town for several weeks, you know what I mean? And so while you're out, you're getting all this here training, you know, my wife's there with the family, and so that's a lot of what she's up against, you know what I mean? And then when you getting back with your people in the field, you going out of town, a lot of times the traveling that you have to do and to be an effective person developing an inspection program at that level, it takes a lot away from you being a real good father at home. The thing about developing children in Cincinnati, it's just a mean situation because there's so much corruption in Cincinnati, and it's tolerated. In Cincinnati, the toleration of contaminating the black community with drugs and with alcohol, the culture that the black community is allowed to develop that's devastating to a family, see what I mean? It contaminates the family, it contaminates the girls, it contaminates the boys, and you have a justice system in this area that just love to make arrests. Because that brands the person. So that person is known now as a person that you don't have to give him the better job because he got an arrest record. You don't have to give her the best because, and the justice system we have with the arrest and the police making arrests and the Justice Department putting penalties on people who are African American, you have a problem trying to raise a constructive black family in Cincinnati without them being contaminated. There's no way in the world when you're around contamination that some of that contamination not gonna get on you. See, once you in an environment that's contaminated, see, doing the best you can will help, but will not prevent the contamination from affecting your family. And that's what happened to any family that's living in a contaminated in Cincinnati, where you got an African-American community. They're going to allow that contamination to happen, and some of your family is going to be affected by it. And this is why you have most families, and mine was among those. They see, their friends are doing certain things. And so they become friends, and they become associated with certain people, and they're going to be contaminated, see? But I'm fortunate none of them got to be drug addicts, and none of them got to do certain things that... I think most of my son's friends are dead. Most of them. They, you know, and we talk about him and we mention his friends and, well, he's dead. And most of them are died because they was doing something that was corrupt. See, very few of them just died a natural death. Some of them did, but so I've just seen that happen. I've seen some of my daughter's friends, girls, and seen the things that have happened to them. And I'm lucky that some of those things didn't happen to some of mine, see? But some of the contamination did affect my family, see? And I my kids have come back and told me, see, I was having problems, see what I mean? But I think the fact that I was constructive and their mother was constructive, that gave them something to come back to. I've always felt that an intelligent adult can select a religion that he feels will put him in tune with his God. And I searched, and I found a religion I thought would put me in tune with who I really felt was my God. See? That's why I became a Unitarian, see? Because it allowed me to be honest. It allowed me to get in touch with my God in the way I wanted to be in touch with my God. But see, when I got in touch with the Unitarian religion, I didn't know at the time that my grandfather had tried to start a Unitarian church in Cincinnati in the 1920s. And he and a fellow had wrote a book about him. See, I didn't know about this. The fellow had wrote a book. He was a Canadian. He wrote a book about him. And when a minister came to our church, just as an intern minister, and this minister, Sharon Dittmer, she came to our church and on the Martin Luther King's Day, and she wanted to give a sermon about the treatment of African Americans in Cincinnati and in the Unitarian religion. And when she talked from this book this fellow had wrote, and I'm sitting in the congregation, the only African American sitting in the congregation, and when she's talking, and I hear her mention W.H.G. Carter, who was my grandfather, after the sermon's over, she says, well, let's have an open conversation about this, because I'm trying to get everybody to know about what's happening with African Americans in Cincinnati in the Unitarian congregation. And I said, well, I want to ask one thing. Where did you find out this about my grandfather? And she said, that was your grandfather? I said, yes. That's... And she told me about the book. And then I bought the book, and I probably bought 6 books, and different people took them away from me, you know what I mean? I got one of them, I won't let it go. But that became such a powerful thing that she got a regular job as a minister at First Unitarian Church in Cincinnati. And when she told them about what happened, they said, well, we'll research this W.H.G. Carter. They had a group of people down there in the congregation, they researched. And they was telling me about what they had researched. And I said, well, I don't even know where he's buried at. And they said, well, we found out some stuff with the death notice in the paper. I said, well, send it to me. And when they sent it to me, and I'm reading this death notice, I said, the death notice said Beech Grove Cemetery. Well, that's right next door to where she was preaching. That's right next door to the church I belong to. And so I went over to Beech Grove Cemetery, and I said, I'd like to find out about this person. And they took me to a grave, and they said, well, they don't have no headstone. No headstone? They said, yes, and his wife is buried here too. And I went over, and she don't have no headstone. And when I come back to the church and told them, and when I got a message to Sharon Dittmer about when she was preaching about W.H.G. Carter, less than 1,000 yards from her, he was laying in an unmarked grave. And his wife was over there too. And so the church, Northern Hills Fellowship, the church I belong to, which is right next door to Beech Grove Cemetery, they immediately raised enough money to pay for W.H.G. Carter's headstone. I contacted the family members and asked them what happened that we don't have no headstones over there. And I talked to my uncles, and I got put some heat on my cousins, and we got enough money to get a headstone for grandmother. And so, we had got headstones over there. And then I checked with Beech Grove Cemetery since then, and I found out I got 2 uncles over there and an aunt. So it's 5 of them over there. And they're all near the Unitarian church that I belong to, Northern Hills Fellowship. And so we really took care of an extremely important family omission by the religion, by the Unitarian religion, stepping forward and doing something to deal with that omission, you know what I mean? And so that became a very powerful thing, you know, that whole thing developed to the point where they took that to the, in Cleveland, where the Unitarian religion had the General Assembly, they took that message up there about how they had recognized they had not did what they should about W.H.G. Carter, and they had apologized to the Carter family, and we accepted their apology based on how they handled themselves. And they elected, the Unitarian religion elected a black head, and he has been the head, he's now the head of the Unitarian religion all over the world. Bill Sinkford's his name. The thing that's important to me is I realize that those who have African ancestry can be an extremely important human resource for the United States of America. And when I saw what the Tuskegee Airmen accomplished, when they went in combat in Italy, and when the things was rough in Italy, see, you had 49,000 casualties over Europe alone in the Air Force, and they needed somebody to protect those aircraft. See what I mean? The bombers was being dropped, and every time you'd lose a bomber, you lose 13 men, see. And Eisenhower knew that going up from Italy, they're trying to fly from Italy up into Berlin, and trying to fly from Italy over to Yugoslavia to hit those oil bases. And they knew those bombers needed protection. And he found out the Tuskegee Airmen, Eisenhower found out the Tuskegee Airmen, if he given the Tuskegee Airmen, contacting B.O. Davis, letting B.O. Davis know that I want you to use the Tuskegee Airmen to protect those bombers. They protected every bomber. The Tuskegee, once a bomber got with the Tuskegee Airmen, it didn't go down, not because of enemy attack, see what I mean? And they had a reputation, the only outfit that ever was 100% in protecting the medium bomber, the bombers that they was assigned to protect. And they did such an outstanding job, but that was suppressed. Most people in the United States didn't know anything about that. Even the white fellows in those bombers, in many cases, they did not know the red tails. The Tuskegee Airmen fighter planes had red tails. And they wanted the red tails to protect them. Not the checker tails, not the others. Get me some protection from the red tails, because they knew the chances for getting back was much greater if they had the red tails protecting them. But they did not know in the red tails, many of them didn't know the Tuskegee Airmen were black men. They, at that time, wasn't no such, they didn't call them Tuskegee Airmen, they called them red tails. But the protection and the efficiency of those with African ancestry in the Air Force was awesome. And when I found myself working with those guys, and I was a flight chief, I had 30 aircraft and engine mechanics. It was my responsibility to have them planes ready to fly, and they was ready, and they was safe. See? And all the other, everybody with the Tuskegee Airmen, we all felt like we was doing a job, and we was efficient, and we had an outstanding record. But it was suppressed. The United States did not know, people in the United States did not know how effective those with African ancestry were in the Air Force. But that made me know there's a lot of things that those with African ancestry can do in the United States if they would just let them do it, if they would just clean up those ghettos and eliminate all that corruption that's happened, see what I mean? There's an awesome amount of human value, and there's always been a lot of human value with those with African ancestry in the United States. The fact is, the human value they had was known when they was in Africa. And they suppressed a whole lot of awesome things that those with African ancestry have contributed to humankind. And in the United States, what we find out, if we use that resource, it makes the nation a greater nation. Clean up the ghettos, and it can be done. See, clean up the contaminated neighborhoods, make the families of black people a solid family structure, and eliminate the disrespect that is so prevalent among those with African ancestry, and strengthen that family, and this will make this nation a stronger nation, and it can be done. know your family and know your family history. And when I look back at my family, we've always tried to avoid drugs. none of us had problems drinking. See, none of us had problems abandoning families. We didn't have that kind of problem. If you know your family and know your family's standards and know the direction your family have given you, then why stray away from your family? Your family have given you a pattern to have a constructive, wholesome life. But know your family and don't abandon that family pattern for being constructive and wholesome. And you not only do better by yourself, but you keep down a lot of ugliness that can cause your family to feel sorry that you're in a situation. You not only hurt yourself when you do things foolish, you hurt people that love you. See? And that can be avoided. See? All the people that have made me know they cared about me. See? All the people, and I've had such a wide range, cousins, strangers, I've had people all in my life that have did little things to make me know they cared about me. See? But then you got to know how to avoid people who don't care about you. I just regret that my father died as young as he did. That's what I regret, you know. Because I'm pretty sure that he'd have kept the family together and we'd have been much, much stronger, because the kind of education and everything we'd have got if he'd have lived would have been much better, you know. But that's the only thing, my father's death. But I had wonderful grandparents on both sides, and my sisters always showed me they cared about me, and my mother, you know. And my mother did so much for me, and I didn't realize how much she loved me. And when I come out of service and looked at my mother and thought about what all she had been doing for the family, that was the first time I ever kissed my mother. I went up to her and hugged her and kissed her. And I didn't even tell her why I was kissing her. But I realized that she had been such a wonderful person for everybody who was in the family, see. But I had to put my arms around her and kiss her. And I believe that's important too, that we make people know that we love them. We tell them we love them, see, and we hug them, see what I mean? And we do things, don't wait until later to hug somebody. Don't wait till later to tell somebody you love. If you want to tell them you love them. In fact, just make it your business to tell them you love them, see what I mean? Don't be delaying about showing you care for people, see, especially family members.